Today we hear Luke's account of that first Pentecost and the birth of the Church of Jesus Christ. Two things happened that day. The Holy Spirit came and filled the church with power and broke down barriers that so often divide us. I am reading from Acts chapter 2. When Pentecost day arrived, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound from heaven, like the howling of a fierce wind, filled the entire house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be individual flames of fire alighting on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. There were pious Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem, and when they heard this sound, a crowd gathered. They were mystified because everyone heard them speaking in their native languages. They were surprised and amazed and saying, "Look, aren't all the people who are speaking Galileans? Every one of them? How then can each of us hear them speaking in our native language? Parthians, Medites, and Elamites, as well as residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the regions of Libya bordering Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the mighty works of God in our own languages." They were all surprised and bewildered, and some even asked each other, "What does this mean?" Others jeered at them, saying, "They're full of new wine." Peter stood with the other 11 apostles. He raised his voice and declared, "Judeans and everyone living in Jerusalem, know this, listen carefully to my words. These people aren't drunk, as you suspect. After all, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. Rather, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your daughters and sons will prophesy. Your young will see visions. Your elders will dream dreams. Even upon my servants, men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will cause wonders to occur in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and a cloud of smoke. The sun will be changed into darkness, and the moon will be changed into blood before the great and spectacular day of the Lord comes. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." This is the word of God for the people of God.
In the little town of Bethlehem, God is with us. On a hill called Calvary, God is for us. On Pentecost, God is in us. And today we celebrate the power of our God who desires to empower us and dwell in us. On that first day of Pentecost, the gift of the Holy Spirit came like fire and wind to birth the Church of Jesus Christ. Even now, the Holy Spirit still moves, calling each of us to share that divine energy with others, to break down barriers, connecting with people who may not be exactly like us, and to build up the body of Christ.
So I've been thinking lately about getting an electric car. I drive 90 miles round trip from my home to Messiah Church and back. And every time I push that ignition button, I am keenly aware of the emissions that I'm releasing into this world, and it weighs heavy on my conscience and on my heart. So I've been looking. Tesla, Audi, Nissan, Porsche, Chevy, VW, they're all making electric cars. The market is continuing to grow. But there's something to be aware of, and that is the charging ports are all over the place. You know, if you drive a gas-filled car, when you pull up to the tank, you can be assured that you're going to fill your car from the rear of the car on either the left or the right. But the charging station on electric cars can be in the front or the back or the left or the right. Something to think about. Well, in 2020, the Korean car maker Hyundai set out on this project to build public charging stations throughout the city of Seoul that would accommodate all makes and models of electric vehicles. And this was the result, the Hyundai Hi Charger. Now, you might be surprised what inspired this design. It was those self-serve car washes, you know, the ones that have the hose in the middle of the bay and they go all the way around your car. So too is this design. It has this glowing, rotating halo that will drop the charging cable to the exact right spot, depending on the make or the model of your car. It is a universal charger. Well, today we're going to take a look at how the Holy Spirit is the universal charger. Our scripture reading today, by the way, Shirley, great job with all those names. Thank you for doing that. Our scripture reading today comes from the New Testament book, the Acts of the Apostles, and it's addressed to an individual named Theophilus. Now, we also know that Theophilus was addressed at the beginning of the Gospel of Luke. We know that Theophilus was this prominent Roman citizen who supported Luke and perhaps even funded his research. And so the book of Acts is seen as a companion novel to the book of Luke, as it continues to tell the story of this church that is growing after the death and resurrection of Jesus. So when our scene opens, we're told that this newly found Christian community is gathered together in one place for the Feast of Pentecost. Now, if you have the King James translation of the Bible, it says they were gathered in one accord. But don't get that confused with the Honda Accord. I know, bad joke. Pentecost was originally an agricultural festival that celebrated the first harvest of the growing season. In Hebrew, it's called Shavat, which means weeks, and it comes 7 weeks after Passover. In the Christian community, it's 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus, or Easter Sunday. The description of the arrival of the Holy Spirit is at first just auditory. It's the sound of this fierce and rushing wind that fills the house where this community is gathered. And then they speak of flames of fire dancing about. Two forms of energy here, wind and fire. But the first followers of Jesus were one brand of Jew. They were all Galileans. And they weren't the most educated group of people. And so many folks considered their language abilities to be rather limited. But God was at work with a surprising design. At Pentecost, the church celebrates two acts of the Holy Spirit, the universal charger. First is that the walls and barriers that divide were broken down. And second is that the followers of Jesus Christ are empowered and strengthened to do God's work on God's behalf. The Bishop Brian Castle of the Church of England offered some interesting insights on this idea. On that first day of Pentecost, he says, "We see the followers of Christ acting on God's behalf, breaking down barriers. Thousands of Jews from across the Roman Empire, speaking many different languages, had gathered in Jerusalem. And yet we read there wasn't a problem understanding the language. They could understand everything Jesus' followers were talking about. But this wasn't the only barrier that was broken down. See, the apostles broke through the belief that the news of liberation and salvation that was embodied in Jesus Christ was available to more than just a chosen few. It was available to anyone and everyone who chose to receive it. Nobody was to be excluded. And when Jesus walked the streets of Palestine, we know that he intentionally sought out people that society cast aside and looked down upon simply because who they were or what they had done. He brought the good news to everyone. And on that day of Pentecost, the apostles were doing the same thing to an even wider group of people. And it says that 3,000 people were baptized that day, and the Church of Jesus Christ was born. Secondly, the good news of Jesus was not simply proclaimed, but it was embodied in the words and the actions of the apostle, and it moved the hearts of the listeners. They weren't simply passing along somebody else's message, but they were given the strength and the ability and the courage to speak about this faith that they had taken into their hearts. They weren't simply telling the crowd about Jesus, but they were living what they believed. They were sharing the experiences and how it had changed their hearts and their lives. And this gave power and authority to their words. You know, God calls us still today to break down walls and barriers in our community. Jesus made it very clear in his ministry that nobody who wanted to be a follower would be excluded. Pentecost gives us the opportunity to look at our church and our community and our world to see if there are walls or barriers. And do they help people flourish, or are they dividing us? Are there some that need to be challenged or broken through or perhaps completely dismantled? Pentecost also reminds us that when we're doing this work, it is hard and it is painful, can be challenging. But when we do this work, we're empowered and strengthened by the universal charger, the Holy Spirit. Again and again and again, we see that God steps into the midst of human life, sometimes showing up in brilliant ways like a rushing wind or dancing flames. Sometimes it's a little more subtle, like the squeeze of a hand, an encouraging word, an expression of forgiveness, a statement of love. But whether God comes in a strong wind or a fiery flame or a soft word, God's presence is powerful. You know, the sanctuary is filled, lined with these beautiful stained glass windows that tell the story of Jesus. And this one, straight down the center aisle, faces east, where the morning sun shines through each day, is what's called the resurrection and the Pentecost window. And it reminds us that God is with us, that love overcomes death, that the worst thing is never the last thing. And then a couple windows over, just above our chapel, is this window. It's called Christian Works of Compassion, and it represents Christ in us as we go out into the world to reach hurting people, to reach the poor and the stranger and the sick and the marginalized. These windows, they remind us of our Wesleyan heritage. John Wesley was a 17th century preacher and a teacher at Oxford University, and he began this revival movement that brought together Christ in us and Christ through us to bring heaven here on earth. It's what we pray every time we say, "Thy kingdom come." It's what the early Methodist people did as they went out and started medical clinics and schools. They wrote books. They went into prisons. They served the poor. It's what we do here at Messiah Church. That's why 23 years ago we started what is now Bloom Early Learning and Child Care Center, because we realized the need for quality early childhood learning for all children, regardless of their family's income. That's why we support our area food shelves and homes for moms and their young children through Emma Norton Services. That's why next month we're going to support the Minnesota Annual Conference Love Offering which will make mental health resources and support available to the local Methodist churches throughout the state of Minnesota. That's why just last month we sent our 7th mission team to the Pine Ridge Reservation, and they took with them 3 years' worth of funds to buy pillows for people who may be receiving for the very first time in their life their very own bed. Several years ago, when hate-filled language around Muslims started up, some women from Messiah Church and from this community got together and formed Tapestry. It is an interfaith dialogue that breaks down barriers and builds friendships. When we heard hate-filled language around Mexicans and Latinos here in this country, we worked at building a relationship with Iglesia Piedra Viva, the Church of the Living Rock in South Minneapolis. We pray for them. We assist them in their outreach. We give them some financial support. And this is a relationship that continues to this day. When we heard about an unmet need in Kenya for teenage moms who had nowhere to go, we stepped out and started Amara International. And when immigrants felt under attack, we sponsored 2 immigrant families that made their way here and have made the Twin Cities their home. These and many other efforts are the extension of our Wesleyan heritage and the call that we hear and we see when Jesus crosses to the other side and reaches out to those whom society ignores. You know, the Bible makes it clear that our God is a God of relationships. And over and over and over again, we see Jesus choose relationship over everything else. There was a time that that Pharisee came to Jesus and said, "Which of the commandments, which of the laws is the greatest?" There were 613 laws, and he wanted Jesus to pick just one. Do you remember what Jesus said? "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength. And the second is this, you will love your neighbor as yourself." And who is my neighbor? Is it the Jewish person or the Muslim? The non-religious? The gay person? We don't get to decide. But you notice what Jesus did here? He took the love of God and the love of neighbor and he made them interconnected. You may have a completely different perspective on life. You may have a completely different understanding of what the Bible says. You may have a completely different set of beliefs. It doesn't matter. I can't love God if I don't love you. With all that Jesus did and taught and said, he gave us just one new commandment. Do you remember what it was? Love each other. Just as I have loved you, so you must also love each other. This is how everyone will know you are my disciples, when you love each other. And how will they know we're Jesus' disciples? It's by the way we love. And if we want to know what love looks like, we look to Jesus. And we see that that love was unconditional and it was sacrificial. You know, the world's greatest symbol of love, it's not the heart, it's the cross. Jesus died, gave his life for love and to break down barriers. No longer Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free, male nor female, conservative or liberal, gay or straight, black or white, all are one in the body of Christ. You know, our mission statement around Messiah Church has been for quite some time, growing disciples of Jesus Christ by loving God and loving each other and loving the world. And how we live into that mission statement grows and changes over time as we continue to discern how God is calling us to love and give witness in this world. In the fall of 2021, prompted by the killing of George Floyd just 3 years ago this weekend, and the ongoing disagreement within the United Methodist denomination around full inclusion of the LGBTQIA community, Pastor Steve called a small group of diverse servants together with a goal of writing a statement of inclusion for Messiah Church, a statement that would define who we strive to be as we make our community and our world look more like the peaceable vision that Jesus called the kingdom of God. The plan was that this statement would be shared with you before Pastor Steve retired, but time ran out and that wasn't possible. So your current servant steering team, after deep discernment and much prayer over every single word, unanimously adopted this statement of inclusion. Messiah Church is a Christian community rooted in the love found in the life of Jesus, where everyone is welcome to be one's authentic self. We seek to provide a safe place to listen, to learn, and to love. We celebrate the diversity that's found in our community and our world, such as, in an alphabetical order, age, physical or mental ability, economic status, education, ethnicity, faith background, family status, gender identity, immigration status, marital status, nationality, political affiliation, race, and sexual orientation. The Lord has told you, O human one, what is good and what the Lord requires of you: to do justice, to embrace faithful love, and to walk humbly with your God. If we are to love and serve God with our whole hearts, we will work to eradicate injustice towards our neighbors. Let Messiah Church be the place where we can show that everyone is welcome here. We lament that not all people have found love and respect within the Christian community. All people are God's people, created in the image of God and worthy of being loved. I give you a new commandment: love each other. Just as I have loved you, so you must also love each other. This is how everyone will know you are my disciples, when you love each other. We believe in the vision of John Wesley that we can love alike, even though we may not think alike. Do no harm, do good to all, stay in love with God. These three general rules that John Wesley established serve as our guiding principles in the work of inclusion. For persons who identify as LGBTQIA, sexual orientation and gender identity will never disqualify you from any activity at Messiah Church. We will honor and celebrate the wedding of any couple who seek to commit their lives to one another in marriage. All marriage ceremonies are performed at the discretion of the pastors. We stand for racial justice. Our church community has not yet become the fully inclusive reflection of God's kingdom that we yearn to be. We will continue to be intentional in our efforts to include people of color at every level of our leadership and our staff and within our congregation. We will work to continue alongside our community partners until our community looks like the peaceable vision God referred to as the kingdom of God. Our focus is to love and to serve God with our whole hearts. This is a living document that we are committed to continue to learn and adapt and grow in our understanding of inclusion and justice so that all feel welcome at Messiah Church. I am proud of the work that that early team did. I am proud and thankful for the work that your current servant steering team has done to compose this statement. There's going to be an opportunity for you to affirm this statement later this fall. But in the meantime, know that Pastor Bethany and I are so proud of how you are already living into being this inclusive faith community. For those of you that are worshiping with us online, if you'd like to see this statement printed out, there's a little box just below my picture that says Statement of Inclusion. If you click on that, it'll take you to our webpage where this lives. For those of you here in the room, if you'd like to take a hard copy home with you today, we've printed them. They are in the rack by the front door. You know, my prayer is that people will look at Messiah Church and they will say, "See how they love." As we continue to grow in our welcome and in our inclusion of all people, so that by our witness and our love, people will find a home here and experience this extravagant grace of God. We have some work to do, but I truly believe that we can be that church. And I believe this is the universal charger at work in our lives and in this world to bring about the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Loving God, send your Holy Spirit on us today to break down the walls that divide us, to empower us and strengthen us with courage and confidence to do your work, to help us grow in our love of you and our love of neighbor. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Christ, that we pray. Amen.